So I started giving the definition of the objects of the syntactic category of a geometric theory over a first order signature. So I said that the objects are geometric formulas in a given context over the signature of the theory, and we take as arrows something which involves the consideration of the notion of provability inside the theory. So I mentioned earlier that there is a deduction system for geometric logic, so a set of axioms and inference rules that I will not make explicit. Maybe tomorrow will be made explicit or not. Anyway, it's not really fundamental. You just have to believe that there is such a deductive system. And so given this deductive system, we have the notion of provable sequence, provable geometric sequence in our theory. So what does it mean? It means that there exists a deduction of this sequence starting from the axioms of the theory inside the according to the inference rules and axioms of the deductive system. So we can talk about provability. And this is useful for defining the arrows because the arrows are the formulas, the geometric formulas. We suppose x and y to be disjoint without loss of generality. So we will take provable equivalence classes of arrows, of formulas, geometric formulas in this context. Yes. Yes, in order to define subobjects, the identity map. No, but the way you write it is by, you see here, for instance, no, that's the convention, so I have made the substitution. It's always possible to replace a set of variables with other variables because I suppose that I am given an infinite stock of variables of a given sort, so I can always make this possible because otherwise it is not properly defined. So I think for this definition to make sense, you have to suppose this disjointness. So you take provable equivalence classes of formulas. When I say provable equivalence classes, I mean that I consider two formulas to be equivalent when each provably entails the other in the theory. So of formulas which we require to be functions in the syntactic sense of the word. Functions in the sense that this free sequence which express functionality in the syntactic word, you see that the first sequence says if I have something in the domain, there is something corresponding in the codomain under this, this formula, okay? So, and the second says that basically this is a relation on, this is a sub-object of the interpretation of this and cross the interpretation of that. And the third is just the functionality, the fact that a given element cannot be sent to two distinct elements. So you see, these are just syntactic reformulations of the usual properties of a functional relation. Okay, so we take provable equivalence classes of formulas that are provably functional in the sense that the free sequence are provable. This is really a fantastic definition because it gives us a category because we have a well-defined notion of composition. You see, it is just composition of relations, so you understand, I mean, what it should be. And the identity, of course, you do nothing, okay? You just change the variable for adhering to this standard. So you have actually a category, and this category is interesting for many reasons. So first of all, you can put a natural Grothendieck topology on it, which is called, without a lot of fantasy, syntactic topology. So the syntactic topology is basically just the geometric topology on this category, because it's important to think about the categorical structure that is present on this syntactic category. So in this syntactic category, you have all finite limits. You can also take images of arbitrary arrows, and by an image of an arrow, I mean the least subobject through which the arrow factors. So I have these images, and moreover, these images are stable under pullback. And I also have arbitrary unions of subobjects in this category. The subobjects, in fact, have a quite natural description. So you see the identity was this. A subobject corresponds to taking another formula psi in the same context, okay, which probably entails the formula phi. So you see subobjects correspond to formulas which probably entail. So it's very, very natural. And so we can take arbitrary unions of subobjects of a given object, and these unions are stable under pullback. A category satisfying all these properties is what is called a geometric category. And on such a category, one can always define a Grothendieck topology, which is called the geometric topology. In this case, we baptized it the syntactic topology. So this geometric topology is defined in this way. So on a geometric category, you say that the covering sieves are those which contain small covering families. So what is a small covering family? So you take a family of arrows like this, and you declare that this is covering if the identity subobject on C is given by the union of the images of these arrows. Okay, so this is how it is defined. Now, I have preferred to rephrase explicitly what it means for a sieve to be covering in the syntactic topology directly in terms of the proof theory of the theory T. Because here you can see the marvelous integration between category theory and logic. Because on the first line, you have a covering sieve, and on the second line, you have a sequent. So you are able to translate the property of the provability of a sequent into the property for a sieve to belong to a certain Grothendieck topology. And these are things that are quite different from each other. In fact, it turns out that one can establish, and I will say more about this later in the course, proof theoretic equivalences between classical proof systems for geometric logic involving the classical deduction rules, and and the new proof systems, which basically are a proof system for sieves, and they concern belonging relations of a certain sieve to certain Grothendieck topology generated by a family of other sieves. And it turns out that these proof systems based on Grothendieck topologies computationally are much better behaved for many purposes. One can calculate much better. In general, to prove that a certain sequent is provable in a theory, given the fact that you have many deduction rules, as you can imagine, it is sometimes a mess, because you have to check something like 20 rules or something like that. While if you work with sieves, it can be much easier. You even have a formula, which I wrote in my book, for the Grothendieck topology generated by a given family of sieves, a closed formula, so you can just check whether the sieve is there or not by verifying this condition. So this is just an illustration of the fact that you can calculate much better using sieves than sequence. Of course, not always, but it is a very nice point of view to have. Okay, now, given that we have this syntactic topology, it's natural to consider the corresponding site. And in fact, yes.
Maybe you can just mention the remark that the syntactic topology just a canonical topology.
No, it is contained in the canonical topology. It is not the canonical topology, as far as I can tell. It would be the canonical topology if it were an infinite pretopos, but just the geometric category, I'm not. I don't think so. No. It is certainly subcanonical. Yes, and that's enough for.
Any epimorphic family is a covering, am I right?
No, it's very subtle, because epimorphisms don't coincide with covers. So it's really quite subtle.
Okay. So no, it is not exactly.
It's not exactly, but it is very near that.
Okay.
Anyway, I'm losing this. Terrible. Okay, so now we are approaching classifying topologies, the construction of classifying topologies. That, as the name suggests, and as it has been said in the previous courses, it is called classifying topos because it classifies the models. And the idea is to think of models as functors satisfying suitable conditions. Okay. Some exactness conditions. Now we can see this classification already at the level of the site. We don't actually need to go to the topos. We can already see this classification happening at the level of the syntactic category. So how does this work? So it works like this. Basically, the T models of the theory in any geometric category C, geometric, so in particular you can take, of course, the category of sets, which is geometric, and also any topos, if you, any Grothendieck topos. Okay, so the category of models in C is equivalent to the category of Cartesian JT continuous functors from on the category on the syntactic category with values in C. So this is really a fundamental equivalence, because you see it holds in full generality for any geometric theory. Okay. Yes, it preserves finite limits. This category has finite limits, and you require the functors to preserve finite limits and to be continuous in the sense of the previous lectures. So continuous means that it should send covering the covering sieves to covering sieves here. So it should send covering families to covering families. Okay, and how does this work? Well, I give just a sketch of the proof. So a given model is sent to the functor, which sends any formula in context to its interpretation in the model. You see how natural this is. Given a model, I just basically evaluate what happens at any syntactic gadget here, you see? Since this is a model, I can interpret in this model any geometric formula, so I just make the formula vary. Of course, this defines a functor, because you see, the way I defined the arrows in the syntactic category is responsible for the fact that if I take an arrow here, which is provable equivalence class of T provably functional formula, when I pass to the semantics here, I get the graph of an arrow. Okay? So I really have an arrow here, because you see I get a graph, but this graph is by functionality, the graph, it is a, I mean, this relation is the graph of an arrow, so I get an arrow. Okay? So this is actually a functor. And in the other direction is also very interesting, because starting from F, a Cartesian continuous functor, how do I get a model? Well, I observe that there is a generic model of the theory here, which is defined in an apparently stupid way, but because it is completely tautological, But I would say that it is a genius idea because it really gives us this classification of models. So you see sometimes tautological constructions such as this one that I will now explain turn out to be fundamental. So how this construction works. So we take, we define this generic model, which is a model of, so we define this universal or generic model. You can find both terminologies in the literature, universal or generic. Universal model of T in the syntactic category. And this, as I said, it is defined purely tautologically. So how would you interpret a sort A? Well, the most tautological thing you can do is to take a variable of sort A as a context, and then just the true formula, okay? Because you see, at the semantic level, you want that when you take the interpretation, you get M of A, because you want, you see, these two functors to be inverse to each other, so you do this. And for function symbols and relation symbols, you do the same way, you see. So if you have a function symbol, for instance, going from sorts A1, AN to B, so you will have to define an arrow between the products of these objects in the syntactic category and to that, okay? But this is just xA1, x1A1, xNAN, true. You can calculate that this Cartesian product is just that, okay? And then here you just take y equal to, you see the tautological thing, y equal f of x, okay? And I don't need to tell you how to do for the relations, it's just the same thing, okay? So you have this model here, MT, and given the fact that this functor F is geometric because it is both Cartesian and JT continuous, it will send models of geometric theory into models of geometric theory. So if I start with this, it's easy to see that it is a model by how it is defined. It is a model of T, so when I apply F to it, I will get a model of my theory, but this time in the category C. So this is how this equivalence works. It's very important to keep this in mind, because then, starting from that, we will prove that the category of sheaves on the syntactic site is actually the classifying topos for the theory. So let's recall what a classifying topos is. Well, it is, if you want, a representing object for the pseudo-functor of models of the theory. So I remarked that if the theory is geometric, then we can transform models of the theory in one topos into models of the theory in another topos by applying inverse image functors of the geometric morphism. So this defines a pseudo-functor, okay? And so I have that. And what the notion of classifying topos is just the notion of a representing object for this pseudo-functor. So it means that we have an equivalence between the category of geometric morphisms. Well, the arrows are just the natural transformations between them. The geometric morphisms from any topos E to the classifying topos will be equivalent to the category of models of the theory in the topos. And of course, naturally, in in the topos. Naturality, of course, is important because here we want really the functor of models, the pseudo functor of models, to be representable. So it means in particular that if I change the topos, I will have a commutative square. Okay, naturality means that. Okay, so that's the abstract notion, and the fundamental theorem, which was proved in the book I previously mentioned by Mackay and Reyes, is that every geometric theory has a classifying topos, and also, well, that every Grothendieck topos arises as the classifying topos of some theory. Now, let's deal with the first part, how to build this classifying topos. So this is a result that is quite canonical, in the sense that we are not invoking the existence of the classifying topos without being able to put hands on that. We are able actually to build this classifying topos, even though, of course, its object will have a very abstract description, but it doesn't matter. I mean, we have this object and we can construct it in a purely canonical way. And the way we do is by taking sheaves on the syntactic site. Why does this work? Well, because as it was observed in the previous courses, we have a fundamental equivalence between, for any small site, the geometric morphisms from any topos to the topos of sheaves on a site, and the category of flat J continuous functors from C to E. Okay? But in our case, the flat J continuous functors on the syntactic site, we proved that they were exactly equivalent to the models. So we are done. This is how it works. Okay? Then, why the converse also is true? Well, because it turns out that starting from a site, a small site, you can build a theory, really a geometric theory. I'm not going to give the precise axiomatization, but I mean, if you take my book, there is this axiomatization. So this is the theory of flat J continuous functors on C. So you can define a geometric theory, which is called the theory of flat J continuous functors on C, and whose models really are these functors. Okay. And also the morphisms are the natural transformations. And therefore, the topos of, by this result, the topos of sheaves on this site will be the classifying topos of that theory. So this means that starting from a site, I'm able to build a geometric theory classified by the topos of sheaves on that site. Of course, there is a fundamental element of ambiguity here, because since for a given topos, as it has been said several times, there exist infinitely many sites of definition, there will be infinitely many theories classified by a given topos. So when one says that every Grothendieck topos is the classifying topos of some theory, it's very important to keep in mind that there is no privileged theory that you can select starting from a topos, as there is no privileged small site that you can choose in general given a certain topos. This for me is a very important and suggestive point, which is important for understanding the sense of the subject, because if you think of a theory as a point of view on a semantics, which is embodied by the topos, if there were a theory which is privileged over all the others among those that are classified by a given topos, it would mean that there is one point of view that is better than all the others. And you see immediately that it doesn't make sense. It's like to ask if there is one natural language that is better than all the others. I mean, all languages are partial, in a sense. They express each a point of view. And it doesn't make sense in the absolute to say that one point of view is superior to the other. So all depends on the contingent situation. So of course, we are interested in concrete problems, so one language could turn out to be more convenient for certain purposes than another one, but these preoccupations could change depending on our interests that can evolve, etc. And so, you see, topos theory actually captures these dynamics in a perfectly satisfactory way, also from a conceptual viewpoint. Okay, so here is a picture which represents what's going on when you have a classifying topos. So here I have given prominence to the idea of the universal model, which generates all the other models, as it was stressed by Francis Bourseau in his course. So you see, I have represented the classifying topos by this yellow star, and the universal model inside it by the lighter shape, U. And so all the other toposes in which you can take models of the theory are represented by these other shapes. And you see, here I have written M isomorphic to the image of U under F upper star. And similarly for other models, N or P, that I could consider in other mathematical universes in other toposes. So you see, this picture makes it clear that the center of symmetry of the theory is actually the classifying topos, because everything that happens elsewhere is just a deformation of an image which naturally lives there. So even if one is just interested in, for instance, the set-based models of a theory, as classical model theories, for instance, are, it's useful to keep in mind that even those models, even though by using non-constructive principles, if the theory is finitary, you might hope to get a faithful representation of the syntax of your theory in that context, still, it is not the most natural point of view you might have, because here you have a strong completeness, a sort of a syntactic completeness, because in some sense you have a model in which what is valid is what is provable in the theory. You don't have to look at all the models of a certain kind to have completeness. You just have one which you have fabricated yourself in a purely canonical way, and in that model, constructively, you can prove, well, it is almost a tautology, but it is not it is a crucial point nonetheless. The fact that in that model, validity coincides with probability. Yes, there is a question. The microphone?
The microphone is here, sorry.
Ah, okay. No, there is just a question.
So it's related to what you said just before that. So you said, for example, given a topos, there are infinitely many sides giving rise. So for a given theorem, say for example, the theorem that Laurent mentioned at the end of his lectures this morning, Grothendieck theorem about the trace of Frobenius being equal to the number of points of the variety. There could be a site, in this particular case there was one, for which the theorem has a beautiful version, and for other sites it might be very
something completely different in general.
So you agree with that? Right?
Definitely. No, in fact, I will give several illustrations of the behavior of topos theoretic invariants in the context of different presentations, which will illuminate this point. Hopefully in a very convincing way, because you see, even by taking the simplest invariants of all, you have an incredible morphogenesis. You generate properties that concretely look completely different from each other, in spite of being generated by a single invariant. So yes, you can expect all sorts of surprises. When you do topos theory, you have to expect everything. And that's very exciting, of course. Okay, now let's talk about.
I wanted to ask, given some theory in some topos, so some morphism from a site to the topos, does it always factor through a site that describes the target topos?
I'm not sure I understand the question. So you start with a site. No.
Yes, I start with a site and okay. The morphism into some topos.
Sub-topos? No. Some. Ah, to some topos. Okay. Yeah. So you have a site, you take the topos corresponding to this site.
Okay. No. The topos corresponding to the site, just some arbitrary model of the theory in any topos.
Okay, yes.
I wanted to ask if this topos always has some site through which the morphism of the model factors.
Factors. I don't. Yeah, you just complete. You complete. But it's not very.
And you take a separating an arbitrary separating family of the topos, and go with a topology.
Yeah, and then. Okay. Okay. But.
Olivia, it's obvious for you.
But I think I would have come to that later. I will definitely come to that later. Okay. separating family. Okay, for a Grothendieck topos. E, so you can regard this as a full subcategory of E. So you have the equivalence between E and here on E you take the canonical topology. This time, really the canonical one, which is given by small epimorphic families, the sieves which contain small epimorphic families. So you take that, okay, and then you induce. So it's always possible to induce a Grothendieck topology on a full subcategory. Okay, so I take that, and there is this this result. It was what you okay. So now let's talk about Morita equivalence, because now that we have introduced the notion of classifying topos, the first question that comes to mind is it possible for two different theories to have the same classifying topos up to equivalence? Because of course the classifying topos is only defined up to equivalence. The answer is yes. This phenomenon is called the Morita equivalence, because in fact it generalizes the classical notion of Morita equivalence for rings. And so what does it mean concretely? Well, by definition of classifying topos, it means that the two theories have equivalent categories of models in every topos, naturally in the topos. Okay, so it means that if I have T prime Morita, Morita equivalent. Well, it means that we have a bunch of equivalences, one for each Grothendieck topos, E. And these equivalences are all compatible with each other in the sense that if I change the topos, I, by means of a geometric morphism, I will have a commutative square. Okay, so we can interpret this as thinking that the two theories describe the same content, because they have the same semantics, in different languages. Because from the syntactic point of view, you see that T and T prime, a priori, they can be completely different. So one can belong to one area of mathematics, the other to another area. And the only thing that we require is that there should be equivalence between the models in every topos, and that moreover these equivalences should be natural enough as to give these commutative squares. Okay? So apparently this could appear as a very restricted notion, or but in fact Morita equivalences are really everywhere. And topos theory tells you precisely this. When you practice the subject, you realize that Morita equivalences are everywhere, even though from an intuitive point of view, you see, if you think in terms of this concrete characterization, it would seem sort of a rare phenomenon. But in fact, just the opposite is true. Okay, so given the fact that every Grothendieck topos is the classifying topos of some geometric theory, we can conclude that a Grothendieck topos can be considered as a canonical representative of equivalence classes of theories modulo Morita equivalence. Okay. Now, interesting question that is very natural to ask is how does all of this relate to bi-interpretability? Because you see, I have talked about bridges, transfers of knowledge, and when one thinks of a translation, of a transfer of knowledge, the first idea that comes to mind is that of a dictionary. Of a dictionary that allows us to translate directly the basic constituents in the language of one theory into the basic constituents in the language of the other, in such a way as to induce equivalences of this kind. And of course, as you could expect, when you have a dictionary, which in logical terms is called a bi-interpretation, then you have a Morita equivalence. Because having a bi-interpretability means essentially that you have an equivalence between the two syntactic categories. Now, if you have that, then you can deduce that also the, because you see, this really is a dictionary because you see here the objects are the formulas in the language of the first theory, and here are the formulas in the language of the second. So it means that I can make the formulas on one end correspond to formulas in the other end. So it's really a sort of dictionary. I'm not really changing the complexity of things so much. You see, I'm just renaming things from one language to another. But if I have that, then I can conclude that we have equivalence at the topos theoretic level. Why? Because in order to construct the classifying topos from the syntactic category, I applied a construction which is a categorical invariant, because I put the geometric topology on this syntactic category. And the geometric topology is an invariant. So it means that if I have equivalence here, I will get equivalence at the level of toposes. So it means that bi-interpretability entails Morita equivalence. But the very good news is that the converse is not true. In fact, most Morita equivalences are not of this form. In fact, I will give tomorrow, and I will discuss it, an example which we have found with a student of mine of a very natural pair of theories which are Morita equivalent without being bi-interpretable. And these are theories that were already studied before. In fact, they were studied in the context of NV algebras. So the equivalence in question is the so-called Mundisch's equivalence, which has played a key role in the development of the theory of NV algebras. So basically, we analyzed from a topos theoretic viewpoint this equivalence, and we discovered that it could be lifted to a Morita equivalence, because in fact, it was just an equivalence between the category of set-based models of the two theories. So we started with an equivalence like that, just in the topos of sets. And then we showed that we could lift that to a Morita equivalence, following that principle that I stated there. You see, I wrote, we can expect most of the categorical equivalences between categories of set-based models of geometric theories to lift to Morita equivalences. Why did I write that? Because, you see, suppose that you start with something like that. Then you have to analyze the functors that that define this equivalence. If these functors are defined only using constructive principles, so, you see, you shouldn't use axiom of choice or low excluded middles, because these principles will not be sound in general toposes. This will be explained tomorrow in Professor Borso's course. Okay, so you should avoid that because if you, sometimes it happens that things are described in a way that uses the axiom of choice, but then you can get a constructive treatment, and so you can avoid that. And we did that actually. We had to rewrite a little bit the thing in order to make it constructive. Then there was another thing: the two functors defining the equivalence should be. Should only use geometric constructions, because otherwise we cannot expect a commutative square of this kind to hold. Okay, so we managed to define, to redefine the functors defining these equivalences in a geometric way. And thanks to that, we lifted this equivalence to a Morita equivalence. And then we looked whether it was a by interpretation or not. And we discovered that it was not. So it is a natural example of a pair, yes. I will show tomorrow. It's a technical argument, but not very difficult. But yeah. Okay, so, but of course, this is just an example which I cite because of its simplicity. But in fact, you can fabricate thousands of examples of, because in fact, I would say that the greatest majority of Morita equivalences do not come from bi-interpretations. If you think from a topospheretic viewpoint, it means that you have different sides of definition for one topos. In the topological setting, it's like having different bases for a topological space. You see that the majority are not, you see isomorphisms, so it's just clear, right? So that example is just the merit of being, you see, maybe the simplest you can imagine. And it's nice because the two theories are one finitary algebraic, while the other is infinitary. So it requires an infinitary disjunction. And in fact, the fact that we have Morita equivalence between a finitary algebraic theory and an infinitary one has consequences for the proof theory of the infinitary theory. In fact, there are certain features of the proof theory of finitary theories that get transferred through a topospheretic bridge to the other theory. So I will say more about that tomorrow. Because for the moment, I want to stay still at a very general level, because if you have the vision clear in your mind, the applications will be much easier to digest. Okay, now, just a few other remarks. As we said, the notion of Morita equivalence really formalizes in many situations the feeling of looking at the same thing in different ways, which might mean describe the same structures in different languages, or also constructing a given mathematical object through different methods. So for instance, I can say that it is like that just because of personal experience, because I have enjoyed myself every time I could come up with a new construction of a certain thing to see whether I could reformulate it as a Morita equivalence. So for instance, in the theory of compact of spaces, you have normally many methods you can do, and you see this turns out to give rise to Morita equivalences, or in other contexts. I mean, the Zariski spectrum of a ring also admits several different descriptions according to the aspects you want to emphasize, and so on. So there are many many examples of this, and this is just to make the point that we should not think that Morita equivalences are rare in mathematics. Quite the opposite is true, even though intuitively, I mean, at first sight, it would be natural to think that it is a rarely occurring phenomenon. Then there is the relationship between duality and Morita equivalence. This is also a quite interesting one. It turns out that many dualities can be obtained by functorializing bridges, by functorializing Morita equivalences. This is the case, for instance, of stone-type dualities, and I will talk about them tomorrow. So in this case, basically, you have a duality. I mean, by a duality, I mean just a categorical equivalence between a concrete category and the dual of another concrete category, or it can be just two equivalents, an equivalence between two concrete categories. And you see what happens in many of those situations is that the objects which correspond to each other under these equivalences or dualities in fact give rise to different sites of definition or different theories presenting the same topos. And so you will have one equivalence of toposes for each pair of objects related by the duality. And then the duality will arise by functorializing this by using the theory of morphisms of toposes. So this means that the invariants that you will consider to make this bridge will be, in particular, the morphisms between these pairs of toposes related by the equivalence. So everything will be clear when I go to the example. But I just wanted to mention that. So here is the point which is connected to what I have written here. The fact that topos theory itself is a primary source of Morita equivalences. So there are many ways you can get to Morita equivalences. You can start from the mathematical practice, have the idea that two things could be related, and then you build the toposes, you try to compare them, and maybe with some modifications you can make them equivalent to each other, and in this way you can find the Morita equivalence. This is one method. But in fact, topos theory as a subject is very rich of internal methods. So you have a lot of tools available for manipulating toposes, for building new toposes out of known ones. So for instance, suppose you have a topos which is not Boolean, there is a process to make it Boolean, which is called the Booleanization. Or you can take categorical constructions on toposes. The two category of toposes is quite rich. So you can manipulate toposes in order to arrive at equivalences between toposes presented in different ways. And whenever you have that, you can try to understand the concrete relevance of this phenomenon, and sometimes it might give something interesting for your concrete purposes. Okay, last point. Yes, I would like to stress that a mathematical theory alone, in fact, gives rise to an infinite number of Morita equivalences through just its internal dynamics, its internal development. Why? Because actually, when you have a theory, you have a language, and then you might discover certain things in this theory, and some other things are still unknown. And basically, at any moment of time, you can split between what you know, or what you pretend, or you pretend to know, and what you pretend not to know. And in some sense, you make a split between the past and the future, or something like that. And so this allows you to think of your theory as a part which you would like to regard as already known, and a part which is what is potentially knowable, I mean, what is provable in the theory. So for instance, suppose you are in the theory of fields, you know that every field is a ring, so you can look at the theory of fields as an extension of the theory of rings. Okay, but you can also look at the theory of fields as an extension of the theory of integral domains. You see, these are just two different choices. What I claim is that these apparently very innocent choices, when you go to the topos theoretic world, they give you different representations of the classifying topos, which will allow you to calculate invariants, possibly in quite different ways. So this might seem strange, because you see, it shows that the metric to which we are used when we work with theories, we might think that two theories are quite near each other, just because maybe at the syntactic level they look near. When you go to the topos theoretic world, they can become quite distant. So you see, the way the metrics of toposes work is not exactly what you would naturally expect. So you see, even such an innocent modification, like thinking of the theory of fields as an extension of the theory of rings, or as an extension of the theory of von Neumann regular rings, you see, it seems like a trivial modification, but in fact it makes a huge difference. Because if you calculate the classifying topos by using one, you get a site which is not subcanonical, for instance. And so things are quite difficult to calculate there. While if you use the other representation, you will have a subcanonical site and things will be much easier to calculate. But you see, we started from a from a completely trivial observation. You see, just in one case I observe that every field is a ring, in the other case I observe that a field is a von Neumann regular ring. I'm not really doing any new mathematics, but topos theory does it for me. So, no, I mean, I realize it can be maybe hard to digest, but I'm not joking. I mean, you can look this comparison between the point of view of rings and those of von Neumann regular rings is something that it is a problem that I have encountered with my former PhD supervisor when we wanted to compute a certain invariant, which was the De Morganization. It was a universal construction I had discovered during my PhD years. So we wanted to compute that invariant on the classifying topos for fields. And I remember that my first reaction was, okay, we use just the classical representation by viewing fields as rings. And then I just couldn't compute. And then my former supervisor said, we could maybe try by using the von Neumann regular rings, because this theory is a bit bit nearer the theory of fields, and so it could give us a better sight. And then we tried out, we found out that it was easier to calculate. And so in the end, we wrote the paper using that other side. And I can tell you that it would have been quite unbearable to carry out those calculations using the other side. So really, this is just to point out the fact that when you go from the logical world to the topospheretic world, the metrics really change. After all, this is the beauty of the subject, because it allows you to put together theories that would seem apparently unrelated. Of course, there is the other side of the coin, things that might seem quite near. You have to be extremely careful. I mean, topos theory is very linguistically sensitive, syntactically sensitive. So don't just work without thinking too much at the syntactic level. Okay, finally. So how does the bridge technique actually works? More or less I have already explained. So when we study theories from a topospheretic viewpoint, basically we do this by representing them by means of sides or other gadgets that one might use to represent toposes. I mean, sides are one way one can represent toposes, but many other ways were mentioned already in the previous lectures. You can build toposes from groupoids, for instance, either topological or localic, or you can build them from non-commutative objects, such as quantals or other generalizations of them. So you see there are many possibilities of building toposes starting from concrete objects. But these concrete objects, I would put them at ground zero, in the sense that they represent concrete mathematics. It's not that invariants are defined there. Invariants are defined at the topospheretic level. So the idea is to work at two levels. The level of the concreteness, which might be sites, theories, or other presentations for toposes, and the level of toposes, which is the one over which the invariants are defined. So we can try to build the bridges in the following sense. Imagine you have, for simplicity, two theories that are Morita equivalent to each other. Of course, you can build bridges also when you don't have Morita equivalence, but you have some other weak kind of relation. But then the problem is that you dispose of less invariants. So I am describing here the ideal situation when you have an equivalence. And in this case, you dispose of an infinite number of invariants, so you can transfer much more. But of course, I mean, the philosophy can be adapted also in other cases. But I mean, suppose that T and T prime are two Morita equivalent theories. Well, you do the simplest thing you could imagine. You take an invariant, and by invariant I mean any property or construction that is invariant under categorical equivalence of toposes. The criterion of identity for toposes, I stress, is categorical equivalence, which is a very good news, because it means that we automatically dispose of an incredibly high number of invariants readily available. We don't have to check whether something is an invariant. It suffices that we express it in categorical language, it will be automatically invariant. So you see, it means we have all the invariants we can dream of. And for each of these invariants, what you will try to do is to express the invariant first in terms of the language of the first theory, and then in terms of the language of the second. Here I have written it in terms of theories, but in fact, most of the time you use sites, so you try to understand in terms of the sites or in terms of the presentations for the topos, what it means for that concrete object used to build the topos, that the corresponding topos satisfies that invariant. You just try to understand how the invariant manifests in terms of it. So an invariant can be a property or a construction. A property, so invariant, it means that whenever you have two toposes that are equivalent, if one satisfies the property, the other also satisfies. By an invariant construction, I mean just a construction on toposes that, starting from two equivalent toposes, gives another pair of equivalent toposes. I mean, it's just the intuitive definition of invariant. And this is, I think, this metamathematical language is, I think, the way we should describe this technique in order not to to decrease unnecessarily the level of generality. Okay, so all of this can actually be seen as a form of unification, because when you build these bridges, you have one invariant and different manifestations of it. So there is a unity which lies at the topospheretic level and different manifestations of it in terms of the different representations. Now, this methodology, as Laurent already mentioned, is actually technically effective because, as a matter of fact, the relationship between a topos and its different representation is often very natural. So this means that of course, the complexity of the task will depend on the sophistication of the invariants, so I'm not saying that it's going to be straightforward, not at all, but in general, it is something doable. I mean, it is something that you can try to do. After all, whenever you build an object starting from another object, like through a certain construction, see, you start from an object A, you build another object F of A, it always makes sense to try to understand when F of A satisfies a certain property directly from the point of view of A, okay? So what we try to do in the case where A is some concrete presentation or theory for a topos, and F of A is a topos naturally attached to it, a topos which ideally would capture some essence of the situation A. Mm? Okay, and just a word about the level of generality represented by topospheretic invariants. In fact, it turns out to be ideal to capture several important features of mathematical theories and constructions. In fact, as a matter of fact, invariants that are so important in mathematics, such as the cohomological invariants or the homotopy theoretic invariants, these are invariants of toposes. So you can look at them as invariants of toposes. This is already an indication of the fact that you can think of them as naturally defined on toposes, and it's useful to look at them as naturally defined on toposes, because then at the topospheretic level you have this ambiguity of the presentations, so if you go to another representation you will be able to find new ways to compute the same invariants. Okay, but of course the cohomological and homotopy theoretic invariants are by no means the only invariants that one might wish to consider on toposes. There are all sorts. Yes, please.
I just want to mention that what you just said is exactly what the model is used for crystalline cohomology.
Mm-hmm. that it is a cohomology of a topos, Yes. Yes. No, but it's of incredible usefulness. Okay. This is a Freudian. No. I'm really convinced about what I say. No. Yes. But did he use different sites, I mean, for... In the crystalline...
The fact was that for crystalline cohomology, you don't have maps of sites. You only have the maps of toposes.
Mm-hmm. Ah, okay, in that sense. Okay. Yeah. Okay, so, we have this historically very important invariance, but there are many other invariants, very simple ones, that nonetheless can be very powerful for realizing transfers and bridges in the sense just explained. So here is another picture that can give you an idea of what actually happens in mathematics when you observe things from a topos theoretic viewpoint. Suppose that you have a topos which is classified by several different theories, so a topos E, and you have theories T, S, R, which are classified by it. Then, basically, whatever happens at the level of the topos E will have ramifications everywhere, at the level of all these theories that are attached to it. Even though one, of course, most of the time ignores that. So an illustration is, for instance, the lattice structure of subtoposes, which has been mentioned by Laurent in his course. So you see, the lattice structure of subtoposes of a given topos is something which gives rise to lattice structures at the level of geometric theory extensions of the theories classified by this topos. So this means that if you have a lattice structure at the topos theoretic level, this will generate these lattice structures at the level of all the theories associated to this topos. Now, this situation is still not particularly striking, because you see, in those situations you might be able to establish the connections directly, because you recognize that the lattice is the same, even though without a bi-interpretability it is not something straightforward. I mean, to obtain a correspondence between the quotients of two Morita equivalent theories that are not bi-interpretable. Think a minute about that. Suppose you have two Morita equivalent theories that are not bi-interpretable. You know that the quotients of these two theories correspond to each other bijectively, because both of them correspond to the subtopos of the classifying topos, and that is an invariant. So you know that there is a correspondence, but this correspondence is not necessarily direct. Because you see, if you have a bi-interpretation, then of course this will allow you to, if you have a quotient, by quotient I mean a geometric theory extension over the same signature. Okay, this is the technical term for that. So suppose I have a bi-interpretability. If I have a quotient S of T, then of course I can get, thanks to this dictionary, a quotient S prime of T prime, which will allow me to make the correspondence. But if I don't have that, it seems impossible, you see, that you could have a correspondence between the quotients without having. But in fact, there are many situations where this happens. So for instance, in the examples of NV algebras that I mentioned earlier, in fact, it is a situation of this kind. You can actually describe a correspondence between the quotients of the two theories, but it is not at all straightforward. You have to make a decomposition on one side, then assemble at the level of this restricted context, and then reassemble ensemble, so it is by no means straightforward, and in fact nobody imagined such a correspondence without the topos theoretic viewpoint. I mean, the specialists in that field were quite surprised, I mean, by this result, because in fact without the topos theoretic viewpoint, such a result would have been even psychologically hard to imagine, because you see there is no clue, I mean, on how to do. Okay, now, technically speaking, what is going on is this. So this is just another picture, a bit more technical than the one I projected. So this is imagining that I is a property. What you do when you have different sites presenting the same topos is to try to find the so-called site characterizations for I. So basically you look for equivalences of the kind the topos of sheaves on the site satisfies the invariant I if and only if the site satisfies some property which I have called P on that side and which I have called Q on the other side. Okay, so I look for equivalences of this kind. Sheaves on CJ satisfies I if and only if CJ satisfies some property which I would like to be as concrete as possible. Of course, I mean, I can always take P as the property that sheaves on CJ satisfy I, but it will be not useful. You see, the usefulness comes when I can find a genuine property written in the language of this site. So a property that only refers to the language of the theory or the language of the site. I mean, the objects, the arrows, and the covering sieves. Okay? And then I do the same on the other side. So this will be the other arch of my bridge. And DK. And of course, the conclusion you can draw is, of course, that the two properties will be equivalent to each other just because they both correspond to the same invariant. So you see, at the end, you find an equivalence between two things that are completely concrete, and toposes disappear. They are no longer there, but they were instrumental for making the connection. Okay, and so in the unification, of course, is a local form of unification because it is a unification induced by this invariant. Of course, I can play this game for infinitely many invariants, so each invariant will allow me to transfer a certain kind of information. There is not one invariant, again, which is more important than all the others. If you want, the fundamental invariant is the topos itself. All other invariants of these toposes will be just you see, secondary aspects. And so in order to get, in some sense, a most rich understanding of the situation, one should consider the more and more invariants. So in fact, my experience suggests that in any situation, any invariant will tell you something that another invariant will not tell you. So, and it's important to accept that knowledge is infinite and you will never be able to put your hands on everything that is, you see, hidden there. You can just extract some things on the basis of what you are interested in. After all, I mean, most things we are just not interested, so we don't want to extract. But this makes you touch with your hand the richness of this duality and the fact that there are a lot of things that will remain in the dark, but that you can decide to illuminate if you decide to play this game. There is a question.
So does it mean that there is no good notion of complete set of invariants, as in classical invariant theory?
Well, that's a good question.
Besides the topics itself.
My experience is that every invariant tells you something that other invariants will not tell you. Of course, if you can compare some invariants, if one implies the other, I mean, you should choose invariants that are in a sense orthogonal to each other. Then the problem is to wonder. I haven't systematically thought about that, but it's an interesting point for sure. Okay, so. So all of this, of course, can be interpreted as a sort of mathematical morphogenesis, because the way you generate these concrete properties starting from invariants is really a way to generate forms starting from a unity. You see, the unity lies at the topospheretic level, and these different manifestations are just, you can think of them as metamorphoses of, I mean, incarnations or manifestations of a unity in the context of concrete situations. So I would like to give just a couple of examples. So I would choose very, very simple invariants to show that even in trivial cases, this morphogenesis is non-trivial. So, can take, for instance, I to be the property of a topos, property of a topos, to be Boolean. Boolean means, well, it will be explained tomorrow, it means that the internal logic of the topos is classical. So the law of excluded middle holds in the topos. Then we have another related invariant, the property of a topos to be De Morgan. The Morgan laws, the Morgan logic is an intermediate logic between intuitionistic logic and classical logic. So all toposes have at least an intuitionistic logic. Some have more than that. And so some satisfy the Morgan's law, some do not. So this is a significant invariant to consider. Okay. Then we can consider the property of a topos to be valued. Okay, we have three invariants. Two valued means that it's, I think, maybe the simplest invariant of all, because you have to take the terminal object of the topos and look at it, its subobjects. Two-valued means that there are just exactly two subobjects of the terminal object. Okay. Now let's look at these invariants in the context of different. Yes, the zero subobject, and you also require them to be distinct from each other. Yeah. Okay, so let's look at this in the case of a pre-shift topos. What you get here is that C is a groupoid. Here you get that C satisfies every arrow is invertible. Every arrow is invertible. A category is called a groupoid is if every arrow is invertible. Here you find that C satisfies the amalgamation property, which is this property here. Every pair of we will encounter it later in the course. That any pair of arrows with a common domain can be completed to a commutative square. And this property here tells you that C is strongly connected. So it means that for any objects A and B, there exists arrows, at least one arrow from A to B and one arrow from B to A. Okay. Then we look at, we change the site, and then we take, for instance, topos of shifts on a topological space. Okay, to be Boolean, it means that every every open set is closed. De Morgan means that the closure of every open set is open. And two-valued, it means that the topology is trivial. The topology is trivial. So you just have the wall space and the empty set. Then, so already you see that even with such quite simple invariants, you see these properties. Take, for instance, this one. You see the property that every open set is closed, and the property of a category to be a groupoid. Apparently, they have nothing in common, but you see, they correspond. So if you have equivalences of this kind, and you have sometimes. So for instance, if you take an Alexander of space, you have an equivalence of this kind. Yes? Ah, sorry, I didn't see.
Just to be clear, are these if and only if properties, or does the property of the topos just imply the property of the site?
The property?
So we have these properties of toposes and these properties of sites. Are they if and only if, or is the property of the topos?
If and only if. Okay, yes. Yes, so again, you see strong connectedness and triviality of the topology. This one, amalgamation and the property that the closure of every open set is open. How could you imagine such connections, you see? But they are there, actually. And you can get things that are much, much deeper with the choice of invariants that are more sophisticated. For instance, let's keep still this very simple invariant and look at it on the classifying topos of a theory. So I use the syntactic site. This tells me precisely that T is geometrically complete. It is a very strong logical property and highly non-trivial. So it means that every geometric sentence in the language of the theory is either provably true or provably false, but not both. So you see, it refers to the notion of provability in a theory. It's something quite deep and hard to establish. But look here, if you know that the classifying topos of the theory is of this kind, you can immediately understand whether it is complete or not. And again, I give another example for the same invariant. Take, because we shall use it, we take an atomic site. So at atomic site means that I take a category which satisfies the amalgamation property. I put I take the opposite of it, and I put the atomic topology. The atomic topology is the Grothendieck topology defined by saying that the covering sieves are exactly the non-empty ones. Okay. Now, if I look at this same invariant in this context, what I get is joint embedding property on C. What does it mean? That for any two objects of C, there exists a third object where I can map these two objects. And again, compare the complexity of a property such as completeness with the simplicity of a property like that. And again, you see, here I stress the fact that I have used the simplest invariant of all. As a matter of fact, I always try the simplest thing first. And again, I mean, I was actually quite amazed to find with such a simple invariant such a deep result. In fact, I have used this to prove completeness of a certain class of theories by verifying a joint embedding, because as you can expect, it is something much easier to do. And of course, you see here the list of invariants that you could consider is infinite. So you can play this game. And of course, in order to benefit from this table, you need decks of bridges in the sense that I have explained. So you need equivalences between these different sites presenting the same topos. So there is a complexity for finding the equivalence. But in a sense, as I have written there, when you take these topospheretic techniques seriously, you are led to do mathematics in a sort of reversed way, because you let yourself guided by the invariants, by the Morita equivalences. You really let them inspire you and tell you what to do. Because you see, you have understood by now that when you have a Morita equivalence, then you can play this game for any sort of invariant, and you will find quite surprising results that it would have been difficult to imagine. Okay, so now I think that maybe I stop, okay, for today, and we shall continue tomorrow. Thanks a lot.